You're here to listen to Dr. Evan Ellis. He's a research professor of Latin American Studies at the United States Army War College Strategic Studies Institute, with a research focus on the region's relationships with China and other non-Western Hemisphere actors. Dr. Ellis has published over 90 works, including the 2009 book, China in Latin America, The What's and Wherefores, the 2013 book, The Strategic Dimension of Chinese Engagement with Latin America, and the 2014 book, China on the Ground in Latin America. If you were here last year, China was a big theme in the 2014 a Great Decision Program. He just has recently come to the War College, so you have unanswered questions from last year, maybe you can ask him. Dr. Ellis has presented his work in a broad range of business and government forums in 25 countries. He has given testimony on Chinese activities in Latin America to the United States Congress and has discussed his work regarding China and other external actors in Latin America on a broad range of radio and television programs. Dr. Ellis is cited regularly in the print media in both the United States and Latin America for his work in this area, including the Washington Times, Bloomberg, American Economa, DEF, and Info BAE. Dr. Ellis holds a PhD in political science with a specialization in comparative politics. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Ellis to our group.
Thank you very much. What a privilege to be here with this very large and very distinguished group of people. Thank you all for coming today. As our host indicated, I'm Evan Ellis. I am the Latin America Studies professor with the Strategic Studies Institute of the U.S. Army War College. I just joined the faculty about 4 months ago, and so I'm just still getting to know the lay of the land and Carlisle and the community here. So it's a real pleasure to be part of this. I was also surprised and very happy to see that one of the most important people for me, a very distinguished mentor of mine, who helped introduce me to the culture of the War College and its intellectual tradition many years ago when I was beginning in Latin American studies, Dr. Max Manwaring has come with us here today. So Dr. Manwaring, it's good to see you, and it's an honor. The comments that I'd like to make today on Brazil are, of course, my own. They do not reflect the War College or the Strategic Studies Institute or the U.S. government in any way. I feel that I should particularly emphasize that when I see that we have another true subject matter expert here, a very distinguished colonel from our War College class here with us today. And so I will try to be precise. I'm not sure if we could turn down the feedback a little bit on the microphone. I'm getting an echo. The conversation that we will have over Brazil comes at a particularly opportune time. As those of you who follow Brazil are very aware, just about 2 weeks ago, the new government, the second term government of Brazil's president, Dilma Rousseff, took office. Her new Congress is set to meet at the beginning of February for the first time. And as we think of U.S.-Brazil relationships, our own Congress, of course, just came back into session with the new domination of both houses by the Republicans just about 10 days ago. So we're really here at a key moment in time to talk about Brazil and the Brazil-U.S. relation. I would also remind us, because many times when we focus on other parts of the world and insecurity, we often forget that Latin America is fundamental for the security of the United States and the prosperity of the United States. If you really think about it for a moment, there is no other part of the world, despite what you hear in the news, to which we are so bound in our economic prosperity, in our security, et cetera, by bounds not only of shared geography, but also of shared business and commerce ties, and in many ways, for an increasing part of our population, ties of family. And as we look at America, Latin America, one of the most important actors historically in the region, especially South America, has been Brazil. Brazil, which dominates literally half of the landmass, about half of the economy of the region. And so In many ways, talking about Brazil is not only important as an academic topic, but it's a very important part of the U.S. security relationship. So I just wanted to kind of set that out as we think about why this topic is so very important. I have a lot of slides with a lot of print. I'm actually going to hit just some of the highlights so that we don't go way over on time. I will try to go at a reasonable pace. So if I'm going too fast, please forgive me, but hopefully we can pick up anything that I leave off during the question and answer period. What I wanted to highlight by means of overview is the enigma that Brazil often represents, especially for us here in the United States. I mentioned the size of Brazil. I think this map, where you can see basically Brazil superimposed in color on the South American landmass, really illustrates very well the way in which Brazil really dominates. And yet, for those of us who principally talk in Spanish, who look at Latin America, oftentimes we tend to overlook such an important part of that landmass. One of the characteristics of Brazil, actually a famous Brazilian author many years ago referred to Brazil as the land of tomorrow, to which Brazilians, in their characteristically cynical fashion, said, and it always will be. Indeed, if one thing can characterize part of the culture and spirit of Brazil, it is contradiction. And one of those contradictions certainly is the long-standing sense of possibility of emergence that Brazil has projected, yet contraposed with a sense repeatedly throughout its history of the disappointment in the realization of all Brazil could be or could represent. And so in many ways, some of the things we'll talk about in the most recent history with President Lula and now President Dilma are really a continuation of a pattern that we've seen throughout Brazil's now almost a 200-year history as an independent country. One of the other things that is often said is the degree to which Brazil is an enigma. One of the English language magazines, Brazil magazine, that covers news and occurrences in the country, has as its slogan, trying to understand Brazil since 1985. Indeed, if it's part of the Brazilian, often self-effacing identity, there's the sense that Brazil is such a complex place that even the Brazilians are struggling to understand what Brazil is all about. Also, of course, as you read the article in the Great Decision series on the Brazilian metamorphosis today, a very good article, or those of you who hear talk about the Brazilian evolution, of Brazilian metamorphosis, it's interesting the choice of term metamorphosis, because if you talk about China, for example, in recent years, we all talk about the rising of China or the emergence of China, which suggests that the country is going in some unequivocally positive direction. There's something about metamorphosis that, we have this hope that, if we have a caterpillar and that's going to emerge as a butterfly, we hope, but we're not quite sure how this process is all going to turn out. And so in many ways, especially with some of the economic and other difficulties that Brazil has experienced in recent years, since roughly 2010, which comes as a very significant reversal of some of the boundless hope and aspirations that we saw under its previous president, Lula da Silva, we have to recognize this notion of transformation to what? That contraposition of hope and fear that maybe the hope won't work out quite as we want. I'm not going to go into all of the details of these next slides, but what I want to highlight in geographic terms, as well as economic terms, historical terms, and in other terms, is a sense of Brazilian exceptionalism. Here in the United States, we're used to that culture of exceptionalism. The U.S. culture is, the shining light on the hill, if you will. But in many ways, Brazil shares its own sense of uniqueness. And when you look at Brazil's geography and history, you realize that there's a lot to that. So, for example, if we consider Brazil's geography, one irony is the fact that for a country which shares a common border with almost every other country in the South American continent, with the exception of Ecuador and Chile, Brazil, during much of its development, Much like the United States looked to Britain and Europe, Brazil often looked to Portugal and the politics of Europe as well, and only later really began to think more about its relationship with the rest of the continent. There's an old saying in Brazil that Brazil is only part of South America by historic and geographic accident. And indeed, Brazil's relationship with the rest of the continent is something that has often defined Brazilian politics and security issues. One of the other interesting aspects of Brazilian geography is that despite Brazil's abundance of natural resources, Brazil in some ways has not been fully blessed by that geography. So for example, Brazil has an abundance of rivers, but the Amazonian river system has not been located close to it, the part of the south of Brazil where development and economic prosperity has historically been strongest. The river system that begins, let's see if I can make this work, in Minas Gerais, basically three very important rivers in Brazil. Ironically, one of those rivers don't connect Brazilian interior to the coast, but take Brazilian commerce away to eventually Argentina. The other rivers basically flow inward. Unlike the United States, Brazil has historically not been terribly blessed by where its rivers flow. Ironically, the parts of the center of the country, as we'll talk about as well, also for a number of years were a vast but fundamentally unusable portion of the country. One of the interesting things also, if you think about U.S. culture and U.S. positivism, positivism in the sense that we have had faith that through the application of technology and effort that we could overcome just about any scientific, military, or other obstacle. There's been a similar sense of positivism in Brazil as well. So if you think about it, the desire to move away from a culture in which development was largely confined to the coastline of the south of the country. In 1959, you had Brazil deciding to create an entirely new capital city, Brasilia, which is much more interior, much more central to the country. But it doesn't just stop there. I mentioned before the Cerrado. The Cerrado, try to imagine for a moment the Midwest, from the Rocky Mountains in Colorado all the way to Ohio and West Virginia. Try to imagine that none of that area was usable for agriculture. You couldn't grow corn, the soil was bad, you couldn't grow wheat. Try to imagine the entire Midwest, this vast expanse of unusable territory. That was essentially the Cerrado, and an equivalent amount of territory. But thanks in part to Brazilian, also in collaboration with Japanese, innovation in about the 1970s, a combination of basically changing the chemical composition of the soil to change its acidity, also some new genetically engineered crops, also a new type of grass that was imported from Africa. Through a number of scientific transformations, Brazil managed to make this vast, vast expanse of terrain usable for agriculture. And today, if you've seen those pictures of the miles and miles and miles of soy and other farms in that portion of Brazil, it has allowed to make Brazil basically the breadbasket of much of the world, including China, India, and other places. That represents a transformation that only happened in about the past 30 or 40 years. Basically, science fiction terms, it was a process of brute terraforming, transforming completely the composition of that part of the country. And even if we talk about the jungle itself, traditionally, the port of Manaus it's hard to get deeper into the Amazon jungle than you find with Manaus. Try to imagine a city buried hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of miles in the most inaccessible jungle region. Now, because it was an important river port, it always had some impetus to grow. But today, in the middle of the jungle, you have a city of 2 million people. And part of that, and ironically, it goes even farther, because thanks to Brazilian government incentive programs, virtually all of the white goods, the toasters and blenders and washers and dryers and things like that, as well as a good portion of electronics, are today, thanks to tax incentives, manufactured in Manaus. And so you have this crazy situation in which Basically, the manufacturing hub for Brazilian electronics and white goods is deep hundreds of miles in the middle of the jungle. All of this just to emphasize the way in which, if we think of the exceptionalism in our ability to remake ourselves here in the United States, there's something very similar and interesting that you find in Brazil. So, but the exceptionalism also goes in the historical direction. So, when we think of Latin America, we traditionally think of a Hispanic or a Spanish Latin America, which was colonized principally by the Spanish, or of course our own English heritage. Brazil really is the only major nation in the region which was colonized, of course, by the Portuguese. Another interesting distinction between Brazil and the history of most of the others, we think of independence movements, our independence against the British, the various Spanish independence movements against the against Spain in the 19th century. However, in the Brazilian case, and of course remember from your European history, this was a time in which Napoleon was running renegade across the European landmass. And so when the French forces came up to the doors of Portugal, the royal family did something very interesting, something that was done by no other European power. They decided to flee to the colony. And so from 1808, the history of Brazil is not a history of independence from an established colony, but in the Brazilian case, the European colonial royal leadership fled to Brazil and said, this is our new home. This is the new, basically, center of the Portuguese Empire. And that went on for a number of years until, because of various differences with what was left of Portugal back in Europe, Brazil decided to declare independence. But when it declared independence as an empire. That seems difficult to contemplate, but Brazil was so big and so powerful and such a significant force in the South American landmass and elsewhere. It wasn't all, we're a humble little group of colonies trying to break away from the powerful Europe. There is a sense of we are something new and upon our very birth, something relatively powerful. In many ways, when we think of the United States, Brazil is also unique historically in that Brazil has not fundamentally changed its borders that much. If you think about the 13 colonies going to the 50 U.S. states that we have today, we have undergone here a process of growth and transformation. Brazil's borders, with a few small exceptions, are fundamentally the same borders that they had on independence. Moreover, if you look at South America, if you're familiar with the South Latin America history, you recognize that in South America, there was a process of attempt to have a unified South America. Some of the things, Gran Colombia fell apart. Various different unification projects disintegrated. In the case of Brazil, Brazil basically stayed intact in its entirety for almost the majority of its history. And so when we look at Brazil's history as part of South America, we have to recognize that it is a very different and very proud history. I'm not going to go into all of the details here because I think we're going to run out of time and I want to get to some of the more contemporary issues, but I just want to emphasize that there are a number of ways across the board in which Brazil surprises as a state that we are used to thinking about states in Latin America. We can talk about the size. The Brazilian military, for those of us who follow military issues, and we think, oh, South American issues, and here's, Chile has a good military, this. Basically, the Brazilian military is about the size of all of the other militaries in South America combined. One usually doesn't realize just how big. And it's ironic, because Brazil actually spends on a per capita basis less on its military than most of the rest of South America. I think it's about 1.2% of GDP. But with that, the size of its military eclipses all of the rest. But it's also other things. For example, Brazil has the largest, most significant space program in the region. Brazil is one of only three countries in the region, including Argentina and Mexico, to have its own nuclear power program. Brazil has world-class companies that invest in other parts of the world, from China to Australia to elsewhere. For example, for those of you who know Smithfield Ham here in the United States, Brazil has a international company, JBS Frivoli, which is kind of the equivalent, this multi-billion dollar, I believe, internationally projected a company. And of course, can't mention Brazil without mentioning soccer and the team that every once in a while does something impressive and, you know, wins a World Cup, or Carnaval or Telenovelas. But so you have a real sense of exceptionism. I wanted to also mention just very briefly Brazil's regions, because just like the United States is more than Miami, or the United States is more than just Washington, D.C., Brazil has a great distinction across its very large landmass. And so in the north, and Brazil actually thinks of itself in terms of five regions. I mean, in Brazil, you talk to anybody about the country, they immediately talk about the five regions. Just like anybody, do we have anybody from Michigan here? You start out by saying to somebody, okay, where are you from in Michigan? And immediately the hand comes up, right? It's for Brazil, it's also integral that the five regions is part of the identity. And so basically to the north, in the states that you see in the north, you have principally the Amazonian region. In the south was principally the more well developed economically and also the start of some of the original agricultural zones. The far south, interestingly enough, is part of some of the early settlements of many Germans and others. So this day you find many blonde-haired, blue-eyed Brazilian gauchos, basically, in these southern states. The eastern states, this has traditionally been one of the poorest parts of Brazil, and also the site of some of the most deep-rooted parts of African culture. And the center part here, which is dominated by the Cerrado that I mentioned before, has increasingly become kind of Brazil's new agricultural frontier. So just as we have the Midwest and the Northeast and the South and the United States, Brazil's regions have very distinct economic and cultural characteristics. Okay. Of course, also, one has heard, and important to mention the legacy of diversity and tolerance that you find in Brazil. In many ways, it's a number of different contradictions. We in the United States like to think of ourselves as a melting pot, but in reality, we're really not a melting pot. We're really kind of more of a salad bowl. The early colonists that came over in the United States brought their families over. They brought their wives, and although they intermarried somewhat with the indigenous people, it was relatively limited. In Brazil, you really truly had a miscegenation. You really had an integration of the Portuguese, the African peoples, the various other peoples who immigrated from Europe. And so ethnically today and culturally, you really do have a true melting pot. At the same time, you have interesting contradictions. You probably heard some about sexual liberalism, and yet at the same time, Brazil is also a very family-oriented and religious culture. The two things live in contradiction. In many ways, even the Catholic religion, because you have a strong Catholic religion in Brazil, and yet it's been mixed with Candomblé and in other African religious traditions. One of the other things that is important in understanding and shaping the current modern culture of Brazil is the very important role that the Brazilian military has played in the country. And so, really at about three important points during Brazil's history, the military intervened, whether to provide political stability or other things. And it's interesting that even, for example, one of the great centralizers and fathers of the modern economy, Getúlio Vargas, was basically a figure very much in support, accepted by the military. And of course, you had the period of military rule, 1964 to 1985. But the interesting thing about the Brazilian military legacy is that by contrast to Argentina and to some degree Chile, where there's a kind of a deeply rooted sense of reconciliation for real and perceived abuses that occurred during the period, in Brazil in 1979, you had an amnesty law. The agreement was, we're not going to prosecute for what was done or what was not done during that period. And so in many ways to this day, there has never been quite as much of a reconciliation. One interesting piece of that is that, of course, the current president, Dilma Rousseff, was herself part of a subversive organization, an urban guerrilla organization, doing things to try to overthrow the country. You know, she was no innocent tulip. And at the same time, she was captured, and in captivity, she was tortured. But it's ironic that she herself admits calls recently by a panel in Brazil to rethink amnesty to previous military officers. Dilma herself said, we are not going to revisit that. We're going to keep that as a relatively closed chapter. And so you have this historic legacy in Brazil, but it's a legacy in which the military and civil society have managed to live fairly coherently together. With respect to the economy, let me talk a little bit about the historical context. Of course, it was Getúlio Vargas and really the first wave of what has been called populism in about the 1930s that allowed the traditional dominance of the landholding classes in Brazil to be able to be overcome by the first waves of industrialization and commerce. Brazil, from the very beginning, really had a sense of the possibility of self-determination, the possibilities of state planning, both under military and other rule. So if you've heard of the term import substitution industrialization, the idea that that a country, by restricting its access to the rest of the world and by state planning, could really try to develop itself. That was very powerful within Brazil during this period. And indeed, Brazil developed the legacy of one of the most sophisticated industrialized infrastructure, although that does have you know, problems with it. But it was interesting that in many ways, during the military rule, if you think about the legacy of military rule in Chile, for example, in many ways, the Chileans are very pleased with the military legacy. So they say, well, because of the military, the trains run on time in Chile. In other places, military rule is seen differently. In Brazil, the economic legacy is a mixed legacy. But let me back up. Before the military, of course, also, you know, you had people like President Kubitschek, who was... there was a tremendous period of optimism in Brazil. During one period, for example, the economy, like China's economy today, was growing at a rate of over 10%. I think over 11% at one period in time. Under the military, there were actually about 10 very good years of rapid growth and optimism. And I think that thanks to centralized planning and military leadership, we're really coming into the modern age. As one Brazilian colleague of mine said, well, under the military, Brazil had about 10 good years and about 10 bad years. And so during the last decade, some of the problems of that growth began to show up. Debt began to increase, inflation began to increase. But the Brazilian, the military period ended, because the military period ended in 1985, it was interesting that some of the really bad period of hyperinflation and problems actually came right after the civilians had taken over. But I want to mention this period also in the political sense because something very important happened in 1994, which was something called the Plan Real. So there were a number of number of parties in Brazil, but one of those parties and one of those leaders, President Cardoso, who you see pictured on the bottom, they came up with a relatively orthodox, kind of tighten your belt strategy to control hyperinflation and other things. And so, in many ways, the success, although it was painful and it caused a lot of readjustment in Brazilian society, but that had a political and social legacy in Brazil. Because the ability of the Plan Real to basically bring hyperinflation under control helped to cement the PSDB as one of the two dominant parties in Brazil and planted this idea that economic orthodoxy can be an important part of the nation's development. So let me talk a few things about Brazil's economy itself. One of the things to emphasize is that you have a number of different engines of growth. Traditionally, you had a very powerful manufacturing sector, but in Brazil as well, you also have had, especially in recent years, the growth of the soy sector, the growth of the iron sector, and most recently, the growth of the petroleum sector. But as I've indicated here, you also do have a very respectable, diverse technology base. There's one saying, it's interesting that in that technology base, there is much to be proud of, And yet at the same time, there are still holes that come from reliance on foreign technology in key sectors, et cetera. It's said that in Brazil, the nation has won five, now six, I believe, World Cups, but has never won a Nobel Prize. That's usually said outside of the company of distinguished Brazilians, not usually within it. But there are holes in that very respectable economic record. The interesting thing, and remember the Plan Real for a minute, it was interesting that Lula de la Silva had been the opponent to Cardoso and his policies much more to the left of center when Cardoso was for two terms president of Brazil. And so in 2002, when Lula came in, many people feared that he would take Brazil in a bad direction, a wrong direction, return to hyperinflation, etc. What he did from the very beginning, he adopted a very conservative, responsible fiscal and monetary policy. And he had certain benefits, the fact that demand from China was increasing at the time, that Brazil fiscally was relatively healthy to begin with, consumer credit was in a relatively good position to start with. But in general, although his foreign policy ended up being a lot more left of center, his economic policy really helped to take off the Brazilian miracle. And so during that decade, what you really had was the growth of the middle class. You had a compromise between fiscal monetary and responsible monetary and fiscal policies and a certain amount of social policy. There's one famous program called Bolsa Família, but it wasn't the only one. But there was really a sense that people are getting out of poverty, the middle class is expanding, people constantly can have, more goods, getting a raise every year. Each year, things were getting better and better. And so this was the time when The Economist wrote a very positive article and put a cover with a picture of Cristo Redentor, the famous statue of Christ with arms outstretched overlooking a mountain in Rio de Janeiro. And as Brazil takes off, the notion that, Brazil's moment has finally come. But Brazil, land of tomorrow and always will be. And so what happened then, even though at the time you had a lot of investors coming in, trying to establish Brazil funds, et cetera, there were a number of structural challenges. One of those challenges was something that is called the Dutch disease. That is, you had a lot of foreign capital coming in, you had increasing commodity exports, which also helped to strengthen the Brazilian real. And in the process, that meant that its value, especially because it was tied to the dollar, began to rise and rise. And that began to hurt Brazilian manufacturing. Now, Brazilian manufacturing had never been that competitive to begin with. It had also often been protected, oriented to serve the Brazilian market. And so you had a number of problems. One was the problem of protectionism. Another was the problem that you have 26 different states in Brazil, all of which have layers and layers of rules and regulation. You have a notoriously slow and some would say corrupt bureaucracy. You have, even by Latin American standards, a relatively high tax rate. And so many people, and I remember I worked in consulting for 14 years before I joined government, and including economic consulting, and I remember we used to do work in the Southern Cone, and people would always talk about the Brazil cost. And it was kind of a polite way of saying, for all its good things, even compared to Argentina or other places, it's just really, really expensive to do business in Brazil for a number of reasons. And so with time, some of these things began to create problems. Especially as Chinese demand slowed and as demand from its neighbors, especially in Mercosur, such as Argentina, began to slow, you saw that by about 2010, Brazil's growth had gotten to a level which was almost in stagnation and indeed has basically flirted with recession for about the past 4 years under Dilma, as I indicated here. I'm going to move just a little bit more quickly so that we can get to some of the key contemporary points. So I'm not going to go into a great deal of detail about the sectors, but I just want to hit on a few key points. Petroleum was one of the newest major export sectors. The 16 billion estimated barrels of recoverable oil. If you compare that to Venezuela, which is estimated to have about 300 to 350 billion barrels, you realize that the Brazil deep water is significant, but it's not as significant as one might think. There was also a lot of hubris, and I remember this period very well. You had a very internationally respected head of Petrobras by the name of Sergio Gabrielli. There were a lot of people rushing to get into Brazil because this was before the shale gas fracking revolution here in the United States. So Brazil, other than that even more expensive, even more remote oil, which was frozen under the tundra in the middle of Canada. So Brazil seemed like a pretty good bargain as the big oil game in town. And so a lot of people rushed into the sector. What's happened, though, recently is that you've had a number of different problems. One of the problems had to do with falling oil prices, but some of the other problems had to do with the fact that there are other investments that are more attractive. And because Petrobras was part of Brazil, has a kind of a nationalistic legacy, Petrobras really tried to retain operational control of a lot of its oil. For example, in one of the most recent major auctions for a big field called Libra, Petrobras wanted to have a 30% stake with the option to have much more. And when you're the only game in town, people will go for that. But all of a sudden, as other investment possibilities start becoming more attractive, it becomes harder for people to get to the party. Now, most recently, compounding that difficulty, you have the fact that Petrobras, in recent months, was implicated in what may be the largest ever scandal involving money laundering and skimming and things like that. And the practical implication at this difficult time with very low international oil prices is that Petrobras had some very serious liquidity problems. Because if you think about what a company has to do on a day-to-day basis, one of the things is just raise and exchange money in international markets. None of the international creditors want to currently give Petrobras short-term loans until it audits its books to find out what the value of its assets really are. So there are short-term liquidity issues, but there are also problems that just a lot of people want to get rid of their Petrobras stock. I think this year versus last year, Petrobras stock is selling for about half of what it used to do. One of my Brazilian friends joked around that Petrobras as a company now has a valuation collectively less than Uber. And Uber had its own difficulties. So it's really quite impressive. Just very briefly, let me mention that Brazil also has been an important leader in green energy. It was a leader in alternative fuels such as ethanol. It has been a leader in hydroelectric power, although it has had difficulty with a number of those projects. It has been a leader in nuclear energy, although its attempts to reactivate and expand its nuclear sector, now working on Angra 3 with plans on doing others. It's proceeding, but it's proceeding relatively slowly. Agriculture, I mentioned before, the real revolution in the 70s in the Cerrado. But one of the things that's happened in the agricultural sector is that, as you can see here, previously most Brazilian agriculture occurred in the south and in the southeast. But as the Cerrado was opened up, the agricultural frontier has really expanded to the north and into the west, to the border with Paraguay and in Bolivia, etc. What that has meant, back when agriculture used to be here, with relatively inefficient infrastructure and in roads, it would cost about the same to ship to the coast here, actually really down to Argentina and then out, as it would to take things by train or other vehicles from farms, for example, in Iowa, to get that same produce to China. So if Brazil was about on par in terms of transportation cost for its agriculture, as the agricultural frontier started moving to the north, what happened was that the costs, the logistics costs, have roughly doubled. So literally, you're trying to move goods like soy by truck along these rickety two-lane roads. And this is a picture taken from the lead-up to one of the planting seasons, trying to get things to port. So I think in this case, it was said that there was literally 70 miles of trucks backed up in this little two-lane road just waiting to get to the port, just to kind of give you a sense of some of the challenges that are faced. Very briefly, when we talk about the mining sector, of course, it's difficult to underestimate the contribution of mining recently to Brazil as well. Brazil's largest mining company, CVRD, oftentimes referred to as Vale, is responsible for 10% of the exports of the entire country. Now, Vale has its own problems in terms of logistics. So, for example, a lot of the older mining happened here in Minas Gerais, which was not that far to get to coastal ports, which were actually owned and built by Vale. This new area, though, Carajás, Vale actually had to build a 500-kilometer railroad just to get the mining goods to the ports. Now, that actually does give it a competition, because if you're a new mining company, it's not just about buying a mine someplace in Brazil. Because if you've got a mine, but Vale owns the access to the railroad and ports, how are you going to get your iron or other minerals to the ports? Well, you've got to come in and build your own railroad, which, oh, by the way, is a concept that many of the new Chinese investors like ECE have tried to start doing. But in general, the Vale, because it's locked up much of the infrastructure and it's built it itself, has a bit of an advantage. But infrastructure has also created problems for Vale as well as others. Very briefly, I think I mentioned some of the challenges that manufacturing faces in Brazil and some of the ways in which it has been hurt by the rise of the real. Although in recent years, ironically, with the 4 years of relatively disappointing economic performance, we've actually seen the real actually come down, which has provided a little bit of relief. I mentioned infrastructure. And the one thing that I would just say about infrastructure here is that it's not just a problem of a lack of infrastructure, but it's a problem of finding adequate financing for infrastructure and getting projects to go forward in a timely fashion when you have a system in which fundamentally everyone wants a piece of the new project that you're going to fund. And so President Lula, during his period of time, tried something called the Growth Acceleration Program, of which about 10% was infrastructure investment. The amount that they actually could get moving forward was somewhat disappointing. They've actually had more success in recent years with a focus on private infrastructure. So basically, they've had success in privatizing about 5 major airports, leasing about the construction of about 10,000 miles of roads, basically toll roads to private concessionaires. A little bit less successful in privatizing ports and railroads, but they are at least working to overcome this very serious infrastructure challenge. Let me say a few things about Brazil as a regional actor. First of all is to point out that one of Brazil's major sources of influence, the South American trading organization, Mercosur, a lot of promise when 20-some years ago they began with Mercosur. But in recent years, Mercosur has basically found itself, on the one hand, burdened by the fact that two of its key members, Argentina and Venezuela, are among two of the largest economic basket cases in the region. And on the other hand, some of Brazil, Mercosur's smaller players, such as Uruguay and Paraguay, are basically resentful of the dominant position that Brazil has had within the organization. So if your best trading organization is filled with deadbeats and people who resent your dominance, it creates a bit of a problem for your trading regime. At the same time, Brazil has traditionally had a somewhat contradictory relationship with the left. And so, for example, things like the Sao Paulo Forum, the World Social Forum, people who are currently PT leaders, actually had helped launch this Forum of Latin American Leftists. And yet Brazil doesn't want to be too close to it because that undermines its ability to be a pragmatic actor. With respect to organizations such as UNASUR and CELAC, organizations which represent the region in a way that excludes the United States, Brazil is also very has wanted that to a certain degree because that allows Brazil to exercise regional leadership in a way that does not include the United States. And yet at the same time, we also find that Brazil recognizes the importance of the United States in other areas. And indeed, as we'll see later, Brazil actually played a very important role in the diplomacy leading up to our recent recognition of or restoration of relations with Cuba. A few brief things about Brazil as an international actor. Brazil, in many ways, if there was ever the metaphor of the, you know, the metamorphosis into the butterfly, you've really seen it in the international realm. In organizations like the Group of 20 of basically developing states, Brazil is really acknowledged as playing a very important increasing role, especially during the financial crisis of 2008. In organizations such as BRICS, which is, of course, Brazil, Russia, India, China, and South Africa, Brazil has basically been able to forge a political leadership globally as kind of this club of exceptional countries representing, in a certain way, the voice of the developing world. And more recently, we've seen an expanding Brazilian relationship with countries of the Pacific and an interest in the Pacific, not only China, but other actors as well. And of course, we have Brazil's real emergence onto the world stage through things like the 2014 World Cup Games played across Brazil. And it's ironic that because although there was certain worried about stadiums getting finished on time, and there were some protests in the run-up to the games, and there was some violence in some of Brazil's worst slums, the favelas at the time, in the end, the World Cup worked out pretty well. The trains ran on time, there were no major incidents, and Brazil was generally seen as having faced the World Cup fairly well. The same thing with the Rio Olympics in 2016. Although that just focuses on Rio de Janeiro, it still is a way in which, like the Beijing Olympics in 2008, this is Brazil presents its face to the world. A few things about Brazil's security environment I want to mention. One of the things, it's interesting that Brazil has traditionally played this role. If you go back to the 19th century, the history gets a little bit more awkward because you have the little war in which Brazil, in combination with others, basically wiped out about 90% of the adult male population of Paraguay. But in the recent century, Brazil, despite the size of its military, has really kind of approached the region as kind of the gentle giant. You know, occasionally accidentally, stepping on and crushing some of the smaller nations, but really not pursuing a necessarily aggressive foreign policy. Now, it's interesting that in recent years, Brazil has tried to do a couple important things. One is to really try to exercise control over its territory and frontiers. But think about what a challenge this is. Just look at the sheer number. 4,500 miles of land frontiers, 7,500 kilometers of coastline, 3.3 million square miles of territory. And so Brazil has done a couple of different things that I'll talk about, but one of the things has been trying to also to work more with its neighbors, in part through collective security, for example, through UNASUR, for example, the South American Defense Council, which hasn't gone perhaps as far as Brazil would have liked, but also individual coordination. Now, part of the problem with the individual security coordination is that Brazil's bureaucracy has often been called, likened to an archipelago. In other words, a bunch of imperfectly coordinated different fiefdoms. And two of the fiefdoms that have never perfectly coordinated are the Defense Ministry and Foreign Affairs. And so the current collective security concept implies that what defense is doing internally, and indeed what other ministries like the Ministry of Justice are doing with respect to organized crime flows, needs to be coordinated in its relationship through the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. And so some of that imperfect coordination, you can argue, has created some difficulties. This was also a really hot topic under two defense ministers ago, under Minister Jobim, but more recently was also Ana Morim, when he went from the foreign ministry to the defense ministry. They lost a little bit of impetus. And also, this concept of collective security and coordinating with neighbors, this had a lot more push when Lula was president, the previous president, who was much more interested in Brazil's foreign affairs role. It's said that the current Brazilian president, Dilma, is not as interested in foreign affairs, and so it's lost a little bit of the impetus that it once had. Just very quickly, Brazil actually is pursuing a number of different technology programs to advance its territorial control and security. I'll mention four major ones here. Sindacta is basically a program to systematically apply airspace control. think about in the United States being able to say we do not have positive control and radar coverage over the entire airspace of the United States. It'd be, especially after 9/11, almost unthinkable. But in Brazil, there are major parts of the Amazon and other places that did not have any type of radar coverage. And so little by little, the Brazilians have been working to advance radar coverage. They've been also trying to do something called CISGAS, which is basically a system of maritime control, ever more important with the oil finds that we talked about before. There's another one called CISFRON, which is basically a system for controlling frontiers, which involves not only sensors and security elements to be deployed in the frontiers, but also is associated with a policy of trying to encourage more Brazilians to actually settle in Brazilian frontier towns so that basically you don't get quite an invasion of the uninhabited Amazon from Peru and other places. And then finally, CIVAM, which is basically the system for monitoring, principally through satellites, but also through other technology, the Amazon. So bottom line here is that Brazil really is trying to increase control over its own territory, whose vastness makes that a great challenge. And the other thing I mentioned before, despite the size of the Brazilian armed forces, Brazil has traditionally been, for about the past 10 years, Brazil actually systematically underinvested in its military. It's recently begun to change that. There was a long postponed fighter acquisition. They were thinking about maybe buying a U.S. fighter. They ended up buying the Swedish Gripen fighter. They're buying some from the Russians. For example, there's an air defense system that they're in the process of bidding on right now from Russia. But at the same time, Brazil actually has its own very important defense industry. They produce their own armored vehicles, relatively reputable. They produce their own specialty aircraft. So the commercial aircraft maker Embraer, probably all of you without knowing it have flown in Embraer aircraft because they're ubiquitous in fleets, commercial fleets in the United States. But there's also an AWACS version of the Embraer for radar command control purposes. There is a tanker that Embraer has put together, actually, that we in the United States could buy some of, etc. And so one of the issues is that Brazil's defense industry thus, first of all, Brazil wants to buy from its own defense industry, but many people believe that even Brazil's collective security, its own defense industry has certain incentives to sell their goods to its neighbors under the rubric of basically common defense and in common systems. The other interesting issue for defense is that there is an expansion of new roles. About 10 years ago, Brazil began to significantly increase its participation in peacekeeping. Principally, the one we've seen most in Latin America is Haiti, the Brazil-led MINUSTAH peacekeeping force, but also other places. And most recently, Brazil has gotten involved in supporting the state military police and federal police in trying to occupy the favelas, the slums. Matter of fact, it was interesting. In March of last year, with the World Cup imminent, Brazil had a problem. The state police pacification forces hadn't quite controlled all of the violence in the favelas. And so because things weren't improving fast enough, they said, okay, let's send in the military. And it actually worked out fairly well. Part of the problem, though, just like we know from our operations in Iraq and Afghanistan, other parts of the world, maintaining a military force in a place where people want to shoot at you and kill you is a pretty expensive proposition, among others. And so one of the things that's happened is the military is saying that, this is costing us a lot of money. And if we keep spending money keeping our units in the favelas, that might prevent us from doing other things, modernizing and territory control and other things. And so the military they're not entirely... The Brazilian military, by difference to the United States, they don't have to worry about Title 10 versus Title 2 responsibilities and National Guard. The Brazilian military has always been a guardian of the Brazilian national security. It's enshrined in the Constitution. So although the Brazilian military needs legal authorities specifically when they go into certain area, there aren't really constitutional issues when the Brazilian military deploy into to the favelas. But because of the cost of the operation, it is a bit difficult. I've got just a few more slides, and then I'll wrap it up, and we'll be ready for a brief break in questions. I'm just going to hit a few points on the drugs and gangs. One of the points is that the flow from source zone countries like Colombia, Peru, and Bolivia of cocaine and other drugs to the United States, that's not the only market. Another very important flow in recent years has been east, basically through Argentina, Brazil, Uruguay, to Africa, and then up to Europe and in Russia. And along the way, Brazil has actually emerged, because of the power of its own economy, as a major consumer. I think now it's like the second largest market for cocaine. And so that has begun to create problems within Brazilian cities. It's begun to mean that some of the original prison gangs, one called the First Capital Command, the PCC, and also an older organization that was kind of a Cold War era organization called Comando Vomelo, the Red Command, and others, one is called the Friends of Friends, Amigos do Amigos, are starting to emerge as internationally operating drug gangs with ties into Paraguay, with ties into Bolivia, with ties into favelas, creating a bit of a problem, just in the sense that Central American gangs are emerging, and other gangs are emerging, the Mexican gangs, along the South America to U.S. drug route. I talked a little bit about the violence in the cities, and again, part of the dilemma, the Brazilians have this very effective kind of carabinero type of force, kind of this militarized police at the state and federal levels. They had some initial success. They sent in 38 different units. The success was imperfect, but one of the issues is, as I mentioned before, it's expensive, and so the army isn't sure whether it wants to continue to bear the burden of that role. But at the same time, the states who have their own militarized police who are doing this, they get their money from the federal government. And so the states are finding this very expensive as well. And so there are lots of people getting very nervous about the cost of sustaining these activities. But with the current budgetary crisis, the federal government doesn't have money to continue these things either. And some states are worse than others. For example, Rio de Janeiro has the problem that because of the petroleum industry that is concentrated there, something like 80% of Rio's revenues come from petroleum. And so you can imagine right now that with petroleum prices in the tank, Rio, which has some of the worst favelas, the worst slums in all of Brazil, some of the greatest costs to have police there, is really feeling the pinch of how you pay for this continued, these continued things. Okay, so a couple concluding remarks. I've covered some of the U.S. relations issues. I would just briefly emphasize that there actually is a legacy of and a history of Brazil-U.S. cooperation. Arguably reluctantly, but cooperation during World War II, cooperation in 1965 in the crisis in the Dominican Republic. Actually, it was Brazil after 9/11 that stepped up and helped introduce the basically initiative and the organization of American states to basically have the entire organization consider the attack on the Twin Towers in New York and the attack on the Pentagon was considered an attack on all of the Americas to which the Americas could respond. And so in many ways, in against terrorism and other things, Brazil, yes, has stood alongside of the United States in this fight. And yet, there are a number of areas in which Brazil and U.S. interests are divergent. One is competition in agriculture, which has caused Brazil to drag its feet on a number of different free trade discussions, from free trade area of the Americas to the current round of World Trade Organization negotiations. Also, the role of the United States in the region. Brazil prefers a UNASUR or SELAC-led region. The United States obviously prefers an OAS-led region, which gives more of a U.S. role, et cetera. Perhaps one of the things, as you know, most soured relations was the revelations of NSA surveillance espionage activities, which it came out was not only against Brazilian government officials, but was against Dilma herself, which she really, although one can say, well, all countries commit, all countries spy, and yet Dilma really took it personally. She canceled a scheduled trip to the United States. And many people say that there really is a residual of resentment to this day, although we're talking about possibly having Dilma visit the United States perhaps in the middle of this year, but there really is a lingering resentment. Now, Brazil has, in the new cabinet, literally that just took 2 weeks ago, has announced a new foreign minister who actually used to be for 5 years the U.S. ambassador to Washington, Vieira. Some people say, because he was ambassador to Washington, that means that he's going to be a great friend of the United States. My personal judgment is that it will be a more neutral thing. Vera, after all, is actually steeped in the culture of Itamaraty. Brazil's, I mean, if you know how left of center the US State Department is, triple that and you have Itamaraty. I'm sorry, bad humor. So there are, but he's considered a very respectable person, somebody who understands Washington well, a person who is not, in the words of one of my colleagues, not a bomb thrower, somebody with whom probably the relationship will prosper. Okay. Mentioned some of the issues with Dilma before. In the interest of time, we can talk about the election that was just held if you want to in more detail. But I want to end on this slide here, which is the post-election outlook. Basically, 2 weeks ago, Dilma just took office. They have a bicameral system. You have an upper house and a lower house. Brazil's politics are very fragmented. And so you have, I think, 28 different parties. The ruling coalition consists of 8 parties. The PT, the Workers' Party, and the PMDB are the core ones. But what's basically happened is that although the ruling coalition is roughly the same size as it was before, the portion of those seats that were held by PT and PMDB have actually shrunk. And the portion held by centrist pseudo-independent parties has expanded. Now, there's kind of a long legacy in Brazil that the smaller independent parties trade a lot of support for what we would call pork barrel politics in the United States. And so the issue is that this could be a real problem for Dilma in coalition building, that she's in a time where she needs to cut the budget, she needs to impose austerity, and yet she's more dependent than ever on parties who are looking for pork. And so the question becomes, to what degree will Dilma be able to implement significant changes in legislation in that environment? The other issue, of course, a few things have been said about her cabinet. Clearly, there is a return to the selection of a cabinet which would reassure investors. So, for example, the person that was named as our finance minister, Joaquim Levy, was a person he's from what we call the Chicago School, economic orthodoxy in the United States. He actually did physically go to the University of Chicago. And so Levy, Barbosa, a number of others, also the new agricultural minister, who is basically head of the Farmers Association, the industry minister, who is basically head previously of the Industry Association. While the left is not happy that that basically a core group of these ministers are basically very close to industry, there's some signal that there will be a relative conservative economic orthodoxy. And of course, the other big thing that's hanging over the country right now is this Petrobras scandal. There was a scandal back, I think it was in 2005, it was called the Mensalão, which was a scandal that had to do with basically buying influence in the Brazilian Congress. That was said to be the biggest scandal in Brazilian history. It's now said that although this is not as political, not yet as connected to the PT, they're talking the possibility of $28 billion in laundered funds. Just to give you an idea of the scope of this. Multiple ministers could fall. It's not clear yet whether this will come back to PT financing and Dilma herself, but this is this kind of smoking gun, and it's not clear how much this is going to grow and how much this is going to paralyze both the PT and also some organizations such as Powerful Construction from Odebrecht, as well as Petrobras, that have been implicated. But what that leaves us at is where we started in many ways, which is that there are a lot of reasons for hope, a lot of sources of strength in the Brazilian economy elsewhere, but Brazil continues to be, at least thus far, the land of tomorrow. And we are looking now to whether that land of tomorrow will always be in tomorrow, or that tomorrow could eventually become today. Thank you very much for your time. And
anyone willing to start?
If you could expound on Chinese participation in activities in Brazil. please?
Sure, absolutely. It's a great question. Unfortunately, we don't have another hour, but the short version. Like most of South America and in most of the Americas in general, Chinese, the relationship started out principally about trade. It started out purchasing Brazilian iron. The Japanese in the mid-2000s began to become one of the major purchasers from CVRD and actually came to replace the Chinese came to replace the Japanese as the principal purchaser who effectively set the prices in iron price negotiation. The Chinese increasingly purchased Brazilian soy, and indeed really were arguably the driver in the expansion of the Brazilian soy frontier. That created a logistical problem because, as I mentioned before, so much of that soy had to come down through Argentina, through Rosario, and in other places. And indeed, that's actually impacted international relations now because you have things like the Uruguayans trying to build an alternative port so that the Brazilians don't have to rely on the Argentines, etc. But and of course the Chinese also became involved from an early point on in the petroleum industry. So you had, and this was really when the Chinese were beginning to shift from trade to investment in most of the rest of the region. So in about 2010, 2011, you have the Chinese coming in, making a major purchase of the assets. I think it was about $7.1 billion purchase of an interest in the Spanish company Repsol's assets in Brazil. Another was a $3 billion investment in Statoil's investments in Brazil, et cetera. More recently, they've done they provided some loans to Petrobras. They have expanded. They actually moved into a more advanced stage of participation. And two Chinese companies, CNPC and CNODC, were bidders for the new Libra fields, attracting which will need about $200 billion in investment in the coming years. And so you do have the commodity investments. On the other side, Chinese merchandise continues to basically flood into Brazil. Many major Brazilian manufacturers actually have long had manufacturing operations in China. But what you've had in recent years through Brazil's tax policy is Chinese companies beginning to locate their final assembly facilities in Brazil. And so, especially in the automotive industries, for example, Chery and Jack, as well as heavy equipment. And so the competition to Caterpillar, which is Sany, XCMG, Zoomlion, Liangong, and others. There's also been collaboration in various different technology sectors. And so, for example, you have a joint deal for a number of years with Embraer to co-develop aircraft, and which was seen as a way that Embraer could get access to the Chinese market. You have other activities. There's been space collaboration, a program called Cybers, which has actually been going on for almost 20 years now. And Cybers was basically the co-development of satellites. Initially, the satellites were using some Brazilian technology, some Chinese technology, and basically launched from launch facilities in China. Although I think there may have been one or two which have been launched from. I think there was actually a problem when they tried to launch one from Alcantara in recent years in Brazil. But so you do actually have active space collaboration. In the tech sector, you have Huawei and ZTE making some inroads in telecommunications infrastructure. The Chinese have had success elsewhere in, for example, construction. But in Brazil, because you have relatively well-connected, politically powerful, and sophisticated construction firms with access to capital, such as Odebrecht, who can get a lot of financing from the Brazilian Development Bank, BNDES, the Chinese to date have not had a lot of success in building railroads or things. Although there actually is some talk about building a railroad which would go all the way across the continent from the Atlantic coast of Brazil all the way to south of Peru. But it's really an across-the-board collaboration. It's not just commodities. It's not just it's not just manufactured goods. It's not just technologies. Military collaboration has been limited but non-existent. There's been a lot of professional military education exchanges. A handful of Brazilian officers get sent on a periodic basis to Changping, where they do basically strategic cooperation in China's National Defense University. They do some kind of CGSC-level training in and outside of Nanjing. There are some other forms of collaboration that go along as well. Of course, the Chinese actually served directly but not under the operational control of the Brazilian contingent in Minas-ta, in Haiti, for 8 years. So there really is a pretty wide-ranging. It's substantively different than the type of cooperation that China has with Venezuela. It's different than the type of cooperation that China has in the Bahamas. But it is really across the board. And part of it is because Brazil has such a big market that many of the first places that Chinese companies have wanted to invest have been in Brazil, as opposed to in some of the smaller countries. Since 2009, China has been Brazil's number one trading partner, displaced the United States. And so there really is a very strong relationship. What's happening now, and see, you ask just a little question, but what's actually happening now is that in Brazil, there's always been kind of two sides of do you do business with Chinese or not. Those who benefit, the export-oriented, you know, iron sector, the agricultural producers, et cetera, have pushed for more. Although even companies like Vale fear the Chinese a little bit because they can also invest in the country and compete with Vale. But there's been the others, the manufacturers, especially in sectors like footwear, leather goods, things like that, who have seen the Chinese as more of a threat. And I think now, as Chinese commodity demand and commodity prices have lowered, you're beginning to see the balance shift a little bit. Especially under the first Dilma administration, you had much more skepticism towards China. But there's always kind of that balance between those who benefit in Brazil and those who are threatened in Brazil. And so Brazil itself hasn't really quite decided whether it's, you know, whether the the parrot will embrace the panda and how that will all work out. But thank you, sir.
That's a very thorough answer. So I almost forgot my question, but I'll try to remember.
I'll make my answer to you shorter, sir.
So a similar type question: does the United States have a stated, or the State Department have a stated policy or direction towards Brazil as far as strategic investments or what not to invest in Brazil? And then does the recent change in U.S. relations with Cuba affect that direction at all?
Yeah.
Of what to invest or not invest in a country like Brazil?
And I'm not aware of this specific, you know, trade policies, investment policies. Now, keep in mind that Brazil is not by any means a basket case. Brazil has access to you know, market funding. It has its own very well-developed stock market. It has its own development banks, which actually go around advancing the interests of Brazilian companies in other parts of the region. So don't think of Brazil as a bigger, just hoping that U.S. Exim Bank will, And as a matter of fact, typically those type of investments don't happen in a country like Brazil. What you actually see is more collaboration. So you have questions like, for example, defense collaboration, defense industries. Will the Brazilians buy our fighters versus the Gripen? Will we buy Brazilian tankers and things like that? So it's really much more of a collaborative thing. And as I indicated before, I think the real issues right now are diplomatic and technical. Probably the big technical issue right now is that the Brazilians, although they're working with the United States on internet governance, and actually right after the Snowden affair had a very interesting and somewhat tense conference in Brazil over this issue, but there's still a lot of sense of, we need to basically create, more fiber optic, more undersea cables, more basically independence from the U.S. system. And as a matter of fact, ironically, that has actually fueled people within the Brazilian defense establishment saying, see, we need our own cyber defense capability, a cyber defense against, the United States. And so I think those are the major bilateral issues rather than the trade. And of course, there are the agricultural issues, which I won't go into right now, but there's an inherent structural competition, of course, between Brazilian export of soy and things like that. There's some interesting areas of collaboration, for example, in ethanol, that have kind of fallen off of the wayside in recent years, but agricultural, apart from defense, is probably one of the big ones. Speaking my personal opinion, as you're actually aware, Brazil actually played a very important role in the year and a half of secret negotiations that were largely led by our, you know, the NSC Latin America person Zuniaga in Latin America, with the Cubans. Now, it's interesting that our Mexican colleagues, who themselves have considered themselves to have a special relationship with Cuba, were a little bit put out that we worked with the Brazilians and not the Mexicans to reestablish that. But the other interesting thing is that Odebrecht, which is very closely tied politically to the PT, the ruling party, casually over the past year started investing in what will ultimately be about $1 billion in the port and free trade zone of Mariel. And if you're aware of the evolving structure of the Caribbean, what's happening is with the expansion of Pacific trade, with the expansion of the Panama Canal, which will bring more and larger volume ships through, the possible construction of a Nicaragua Canal, etc., that all of the Caribbean nations are looking at positioning themselves as basically establishing deep water trade consolidation hubs. Now, given that one of the most important things to be an effective trade, a consolidation port, is you have to have access to U.S. East Coast ports, which Cuba has not. And so it was kind of, without implicating any wrongdoing, I would say it was kind of curious that, for many of us at the time, that Odebrecht chose to commit $1 billion in investment in a hub port that didn't seem to have any commercial utility, unless that you made a really good guess that in the near future the U.S. embargo would be dropped. And so when it came out that Brazil had helped out, some of us said, that's interesting, given that Odebrecht is so close to the PT, and they just happen to commit to $1 billion in Mariel. But it's a twisted road without any. Well, I'll leave it at that. But thank you for the question, sir.
How important is tourism to the economy
of Brazil?
It's
a good question. And I would put it in the context of saying, how important is tourism to the economy of the United States? In other words, there are parts of the United States, Miami, Washington, D.C., probably less so Carlisle, although it's beautiful here, that make a lot of money off of tourism. And so in the same sense, Brazil makes a lot of money in tourism, in Rio de Janeiro, and there are other, Manaus gets a certain amount of adventure jungle tourism, Recife, places like that. But Brazil is actually relatively unknown as a tourist site. I'd say if you got this room, quick test. How many people here have been on vacation to Brazil? There's probably an artificial bias here because we've got a group of people interested in Brazil. Okay, how many people have been to Peru or Machu Picchu? Okay. How many people have been to Mexico? Okay, I rest my case. Although Brazil occupies half of the continent of South America with half the population and half of the economy, for us, even those of us que nos hablan un poquito de español, for us, Mexico and Machu Picchu are a lot more familiar than Rio and Recife. But so it's important to Brazil, but it's not, and it's certainly dwarfed by, like in the United States, it's dwarfed by industry, it's dwarfed by agriculture, it's dwarfed by iron, it's dwarfed by technology. But it is important. But thank you for the question. That's a great question. Appreciate it.
One of the Pennsylvania products, well known, is the Heinz Company, which was, it's an economic question, was through Buffett and acquired by a Brazilian company. Does that portend for more Brazilian movement toward in the United States?
It's a great question. The interesting thing about Brazil is that Brazil does have a number of world-class companies that do invest internationally, that invest in China, that invest in India, that invest in the United States. So, for example, here in Pennsylvania, Brazil's leading petrochemicals company has Braskem has a production facility here that shares projects with different clients. I would say it's not. In the sense that we often in the United States think of we the sophisticated Americans are going to go and invest and show show our investor recipients, how to tie their shoes and things like that. I mean, it's a very parallel. I mean, there are things that the Brazilians have in terms of technology that are useful. There are things that we have that the Brazilians want. There's a very fruitful educational exchange. Dilma right now is trying to expand it into something called Science Without Borders, trying to get 100,000 Brazilians coming to the United States and vice versa. So although clearly there are parts of the U.S. economy and technology sectors that are probably on balance, we probably export more tech to Brazil than the Brazil exports to us. But in general, there's a very healthy exchange at the industrial level. I mean, U.S. Department of Defense is looking at Embraer as a source of its aircraft. I mean, so it's a there is ever more important in this globalized world. There is ever more important collaboration, and Brazil certainly is a dignified partner with companies in which we find that fruitful cooperation. But a great question. Thank you, sir. Yes, sir.
How important are the vestigial ideologies of the 20th century, right versus left from the Cold War, and how have they evolved in the political realm in Brazil?
That's a great question. It's a complex question, but let me see if I can give it the depth that it deserves. One of the things in Brazil and many other countries, especially in the Southern Cone, has been a real wrestling of what is the path that South America will choose. And I think many in recent years have taken a look at, there was a recognition on the one hand that the neoliberal moment that we had in the post-Cold War in the 90s really did not solve some of the fundamental developmental and social problems in the region. They privatized, but then in privatization, Latin American style, the rich still end up getting richer because they got access to everything that was privatized, et cetera. And so you really had two responses. One response was indeed Cardoso was in many ways part of that kind of neoliberal moment that Francis Fukuyama spoke about after the fall of the Berlin Wall and the Soviet Union. But you really saw two responses. One was a social response. What you saw with the Concertación in Chile, what you saw to some degree with the PT in Brazil, which is we need to have responsible fiscal and economic policies in open markets, but we also need to have take care of social needs, and so with Bolsa Familia and with other programs, Brazil was kind of one of those nations that really tried to find that kind of social democracy middle ground, which is probably especially necessary in the circumstances of Brazil and many Latin American countries. Now, obviously one of the other answers was the answer that we know from the ALBA countries, the Bolivarian Alliance, the Venezuela, which was a populist response. We need to withdraw again from the capitalist system. We need to make the state the determiner and redistributor of wealth. And so I think there's two very interesting debates going on right now. I think one is between a new centrist policy versus a populist policy, both of which involve compromise between investment and taking care of righting social and economic inequities. But there's another one that's very, very interesting, and thank you for the opportunity to mention it. In many ways, the ideologies of the 20th century were democracy versus fascism, free market versus communism, et cetera, were fundamentally defined by an Atlantic divide. It was the United States and in Europe looking at what types of regime would prevail in the Atlantic. Not only just communism, but the Bretton Woods financial system, et cetera. Today, the 21st century, we are seeing the rise of the Pacific community. And to me, there's a very, very interesting question of what is the economic and political regime which defines this emerging political Pacific community. And by Pacific, I also mean Chile, Mexico, Panama, Costa Rica, et cetera. And you're seeing two answers, and competing answers. One of the answers is defined by the countries of what would call themselves the Pacific Alliance. Mexico, Peru, Chile, Costa Rica, Panama, et cetera. which is a focus on markets, rule of law, respect for intellectual property, the Trans-Pacific Partnership is part of this. The other alternative is much more of a statist alternative. All the countries have principally said we believe that the best way to interact with China is through state-to-state interactions, which bring Chinese state investment to our countries. There is a kind of a middle ground, which is the Brazilian approach, which is we will simultaneously protect and we will deal some state-to-state and we will deal somewhat at the market level. And my point in this very long thing is that for me, this is the really exciting, important ideological divide of the 21st century. It's the, what regime defines the Pacific community? And it's not communism versus free marketism. It's not democracy versus fascism. It is fundamentally a concept of free markets, rule of law, and contract that governs interchange versus a statist approach that governs that interchange. And like I said, I think Brazil is kind of in the middle on this right now. ALDA's in one place and the Pacific Alliance countries are in the other. But to me, that's the really interesting new divide that we're seeing. And oh, by the way, that's not a divide that we defined in the United States. That's a divide that the region itself is currently in the process of defining. But great question. Thank you, sir. Sir.
The Amazon River Basin, what is Brazil doing to protect it? I saw on one of those slides you have a lot of agriculture encroaching on the boundary there. Mm-hmm. Where's it going with that in that regard?
No, that's a great question. I will confess that ecological issues are not my strong point. What I am aware of course, is that there are a number of things. The surveillance system that I pointed out, one of the ideas is the importance of doing a monitoring and to being aware of things like illegal logging, which is one of the sources of erosion of the Amazon basin. One of the others, part of the difficulty also is some of the new infrastructure that you're building actually makes the Amazon more accessible to Trans-Pacific commerce, which, oh, by the way, also makes it more accessible to loggers and others who would encroach on that. And also, simply the expansion of the soy frontier ever more towards the north begins to encroach upon on some of that area. And so I think for Brazil, it's a bit of a challenge between to what degree do you support development and that the Amazon concept is caught up in this. Is Brazil's goal to be a green country or is it to be a developed country or is it, someplace in between? And there are two interesting data points on that. One of the interesting data points is that within the Brazilian defense establishments, and this is not official Brazilian policy, so my distinguished colonel will probably say no, we don't. But one of the concepts looking at Brazil, when you hear kind of some of the echo dialogue in the echo discourse, the Brazilian Amazon is internationally treasured property and this and that, and it's the lung of the world. Well, if you're the lung of the world, and the lung of the world is in control of a particular country who decides to look at it, use it for development, well, then what happens if the world community says, well, you're our lung, so we want to come in and take control of the Amazon and stop you from developing it? And so there are, not official policy, but there are concerns and concepts as Brazil looks at the world that we European U.S. do-gooders, could have designs on the international on the Amazon in the name of global stability. So it goes far beyond just the echo dimension of this. Things like drug trafficking, that is also a significant source of incursion in this. But I mean, it's a vast, vast area. I mean, it's difficult to underestimate just how big that basin is, to understand the challenges of exercising effective control against, drug labs, loggers, developers, et cetera. But it is an expanding problem, and it is one that certainly... And the other thing that you find is that within Brazil's 39-person cabinet, you have, within the same cabinet, pro-industry people and pro-environmentalist people. There's even actually two different, basically, labor ministers in agriculture that have two competing concepts within the same cabinet. And so even the government, Dilma's government itself, is not fully decided between development and protection. So I think this is still an evolving thing, is probably the best answer that I could give you. But it's a great question, obviously a very important one, especially for Brazil.
Could you please comment on the educational system from the bottom up through universities?
Sure. Very briefly, education is not my area of specialty, but what I am aware of is that there are some significant difficulties in the Brazilian system, and Brazil loses an awful lot of its youth, especially in the favelas, who basically drop out of the system. And so although you have high official rates of literacy, functional literacy, especially in poor areas, are lower. The public education system, the quality, like many nations in Latin America, is not always up to standards. And that means that a lot of the haves do send their kids to private schools. And so there are ongoing, and as a matter of fact, as the article itself talks about, I mean, this is an issue, of how does Brazil invest in the education in the future to fully realize its human potential? Because, I mean, you've got 200 million people, and that's a lot of human potential.
How effective is the system of taxation how effective is it in distributing taxation throughout the population that would finance the economic needs of a country like Brazil?
Great question. First of all, Brazil's corporate tax rates are actually on the high end if you compare them to many other Latin American countries. And also, Brazil has a relatively well-developed professional bureaucracy, and so the amount of money, arguably, that it loses through tax evasion is not quite as bad as you find in some other Latin American countries. So overall, Brazil has a high rate of taxes, it gets a lot of taxes, and tax evasion is, while serious, it is not, it is not as bad as it is elsewhere. Now, the redistribution, you get into a number of issues. One is concern over basically corruption. And in many cases, it's more just pork than corruption. It's basically doing projects at the state level. Brazil has a much larger state sector, for example, than we do here in the United States. And much of that oftentimes results in a system of patronage and friends and who gets the contract or who gets the official contract and subs it out to the person that's actually going to do the real work. Beyond that, you also have the social dimension of what you raised. You talk about, does Brazil get the education that it pays for, but also, and one of the things that made Lula very popular, the previous Brazilian president, was a program called Bolsa de Família, which is basically, fundamentally a cash transfer program. So it was basically, we are going to make sure that the poorest families get some basic basic minimum stuff. And indeed, the poverty, if I remember my statistics off the top of my head, I think the drop went from something like just under 30% down to like 9%. And so Brazil made significant, matter of fact, Bolsa Família was actually studied by many other countries as, how you could make a workable social program. Now, there are still problems and issues. For example, how do you make sure that people who get the money actually send their kids to school? How do you make sure that they, actually do certain other things that you socially desire? So there are still problems there with Bolsa Família and with other programs. But the progress it's made has been seen as a model for other places. So that's about the most complete answer I can give you on that one. Yes, sir.
With that progress, has there been improvement in the favelas? Have the favelas shrunk? And is there a solution to that housing issue?
That's a great question. My best understanding is that in physical terms and in population terms, the favelas have not shrunk. If anything, that they have grown. As a matter of fact, one of the phenomena in Brazil over the past 30 to 40 years has been just the phenomenal industrialization, the process by which people have gone from the countryside to the cities, especially major urban hubs, such as Rio, such as Sao Paulo, such as I mentioned, even Manaus. You've got 2 million people in the middle of the jungle, and that becomes a magnet for people who live in that region. Having said that, you also get into the question of the conditions in the favelas, because the introduction of demand for cocaine, expanded drug use, criminalities, the favelas probably became worse as a kind of a no man's land for development. If you've ever seen or been near the favelas, it's a concrete labyrinth of things that are built on top of things. It's almost impossible to get into these things. I mean, these are built on hillsides, sometimes the narrowest road, sometimes accessible only by stairs and things like that. So in many ways, it was hoped that at least the urban pacification program and the sending in of these militarized police units would at least bring down the violence and hope to restore control, which becomes the basis for anything socially you want to do. I mean, you've got to deal with the violence before you deal with that. And while it brought the violence down some, even now the operations in the favelas have largely been regarded as a mixed success. They displaced some of the people. Previously, some of the worst favelas were in Rio and Sao Paulo in the southeast. Now, some of the situation with some of the slums and urban areas in the always poor north-northeast are now getting worse. And so there's incomplete progress at best, although at a macro level, as I alluded to before, the statistics would show that at least the rates of poverty have actually dropped. And there actually is a very well-established Brazilian professional class in virtually all of its major cities and in countryside.
One more question.
Yes, sir.
You mentioned the green energy thing. Now, the press, when we were having the big scares and everything, sort of indicated Brazil was the ideal place, and most of the energy for the vehicles was coming from the green energy. Is that true, or is the petro the big thing yet?
Great question. For many years, the progress that Brazil made in green energy was not fully recognized. Basically, if you think about the growing conditions in Brazil, where in the vast majority of Brazil, year round, you can grow crops, and that makes the productivity for things like sugarcane just far beyond what you can achieve with getting ethanol out of something like corn in the United States. And so, for a number of years, even though we have long subsidized our ethanol industry here in the United States, Brazil actually, with much less subsidies, achieved far greater results. And there's also scientific results, which were actually the fruit of collaboration between the United States and Brazil. But even before Brazil knew that it would have all of this pre-salt oil, they really were turning to ethanol as one of a multi-pronged strategy to try to eliminate dependence on oil imports. And so especially in the early 2000s, this was a great success story, Brazilian ethanol. Now, in the intervening years, in part because of lowering oil prices and in part because of a number of other difficulties, the Brazilian ethanol industry, to the best of my knowledge, has stagnated, and U.S.-Brazil ethanol collaboration also has stagnated to some degree as well. But it still continues to be an important part. But I think other things have kind of bypassed in terms of the political momentum there in the country. Thanks.
Okay. So, on behalf of the group, Dr. Ellis, I'd like to thank you very much for taking time. And
thank you very much.
To talk to us.
Thank you very much.
Please accept this
thank you.
Small gift from us.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
You're welcome.